This is a high-level summary. A couple people wondered, where do all the notes go? The notes don't go away. The notes are all carefully assembled and will always be with us. And this is a very high-level summary that we're going to do right now based on really 20 minutes of assembly. Ultimately, there's going to be a much larger report, of which this will certainly be a part, along with the results from the other summits. So first, who is here? About 43% of the people that attended today were from business, 21% from education, 32% from government, and 19% from government and 17% from other parts of the community. A nice, diverse turnout. These were the challenges that Tim reviewed with you earlier today. Here are the top strategies that people suggested, that the group suggested, that business might pursue to improve workforce outcomes. First, offer on-the-job and continual training. Keep improving the quality of the workforce. And in particular, teach management and supervisory skills. One group that I sat with had this great way of putting it. When it comes to retention, people don't quit a company as much as they quit a boss. So that one of the things we all can do in business to improve our retainage is to make sure our supervisors and managers are as good as they can be. Offer more internships. Give young people more of an opportunity to experience work, to try things out, to see if it's what they like. Provide mentoring from the get-go to foster retention. One of the things that people our age may have forgotten is what it's like to be at the beginning, to have your first job, your first career. You need someone to help guide you through the process. Provide better visibility into in-house upward mobility opportunities. Many young people say to me all the time, where do I go from here if I want to stay in this organization? I used to work for the Target Corporation, and I remember one of their HR people saying, one of our challenges is that so many of our employees think their next career opportunity is somewhere else, that they have to leave Target to have their second career. Why couldn't they stay? So be thinking about what is the in-house way. Create a work environment that's attractive to the changing workforce. You know, it's not all like it used to be. And how do we offer the kind of work schedules and work opportunities that will be truly attractive to the diversity of people that are going to be knocking on our doors? Fund the educational system, system and programs needed to produce the candidates that you want in your positions. Actually form real financial partnerships with educators to deliver the kind of candidates that you're looking for. Cooperate rather than compete when it comes to workforce issues. Yes, it's true that every business thinks they're out there on their own, and they, you know, if they don't get that talent, nobody else will, but the facts are that we're sharing talent increasingly across businesses, so doesn't it make sense for us to cooperate in getting the talent that we need? And wages. Wages are an issue. They came up in many, many of the groups, and if the value proposition is right, can't the wage proposition be right as well? Top education strategies. Educate guidance counselors on the full variety of career opportunities and provide career counseling earlier. Give our young people a real sense of the possibilities that are out there. That there isn't only one track to success, there are actually multiple tracks to success built on their interests, their capabilities, and so on. Link scholarships to requirements for in-state work post-graduation. The state's going to invest in young people, ask that young people invest in the state. Assure articulation between programs, so between programs in the workforce training world, but also in community colleges and the four-year schools, so that it's easy to move through the educational system and end up acquiring the skills and capabilities that are necessary for work. Provide foundational skills training. Many of you talked about all those basic skills, even more basic than basic skills. Showing up on time, work ethic, understanding how to relate to others, but also basic skills in reading, math, and so on that are so necessary to succeed in the world of work. Increase partnerships with business. I thought one of the most interesting conversations I listened to was about the lack of communication between these two sectors. that somehow educators are not sufficiently connected to the world of work today, and business people, for whatever reason, are unwilling or unable to communicate effectively with education about what they're really looking for. So really create a strong, powerful feedback mechanism so both educators and business people are in touch with one another in real time about the challenges they face. Change the perception of technical education. If there's one thing we've heard at all six of these summits, this is one of them. The skills required, the technical skills required today in most of our jobs exceed the highest level graduation requirements that I experienced when I went to school. And yet we talk about this too often like it's a second choice. And it actually is a wonderful first choice for many, many, many of our young people. And foster innovation, that the education system, the educators should be a resource of innovation and entrepreneurship in building those capacities and outlooks in our future workforce. What about the government? Well, one of the things we heard in many of your groups was that the government should keep doing this, getting people together to educate and facilitate these conversations, to get the sectors talking to one another in real time about what's going on. Develop programs to help fund those internships that we talked about a couple slides ago. Making funding resources easier to support identifying, recruiting, and training candidates. The state runs workforce organizations and job boards and so on. Make that easier and more reliable, I suppose. I heard in a couple groups that I participated in the need to assure that public transportation can cover all the shifts. Somebody made the point that if you want to build a workforce in healthcare, you got to be able to get folks there 24/7. And if our transportation systems can't do that, it makes it difficult to build that industry. Increase the use of DLL programs, Department of Labor programs, that are available for youth and refugees and low-skilled workers to create a skilled workforce. Continue the Housing Opportunity Fund. Facilitate the sharing of best practices across communities, again, like what we've been doing today, not only to get information across the sectors, but to build trust among the sectors to work on these difficult challenges. Reinvest in the community, creating a place where people want to live. This includes issues like housing and transportation that are increasingly a challenge in our communities. Funding education, make sure our education system has the resources necessary to meet our workforce needs. A real important example that came up many times was the technical schools, technical education. And finally, evaluating regulations. Looking at our regulatory environment across the state to make sure that the regulations are actually effective, that they do what they're set out to do, and that there's a sense of business friendliness, that the regulatory environment is actually promoting the success of our businesses. What about others in the community? What could they do? Well, promote the quality of life in South Dakota and help market the community. I happen to live in Minnesota, so I see a lot of the way that South Dakota is promoted outside of South Dakota. A lot, and frankly, it's very attractive. I don't know how South Dakota is promoted inside South Dakota, and whether or not our families and potential workers are getting the same message that I'm getting. Offer parenting classes to help young parents understand their role in the education of their children. That is the future workforce. Provide programs for populations that have particular needs, families that have latchkey kids, ESL families, or families with low skill populations, giving them support to become effective participants in the workforce. Housing. Provide for childcare availability and affordability. Childcare is a barrier for many potential workers. Foster and encourage communication among community organizations and foster opportunities for students to volunteer. This is another way to get students into the life of the community and the life of our business organizations. And then we talked about cross-sector ideas. One was fostering private-public partnerships to support life skills and training for young people, so make this everybody's business, not just somebody's business. Foster business partnerships with career and technical education, so really create that connection between those two important sectors. And encourage business education partnerships of all kinds, from early ages on, developing curriculum, building advisory councils, that whole feedback mechanism that we talked about earlier. What impresses me the most about these ideas is the range. There are lots of possibilities here. There are lots of strategies that could be pursued. You've identified just here 30 or 40 potential strategies. This gives, I think, all of us plenty to work with. Now, there are plenty of work to do to assess and evaluate these and decide which ones, you know, we really want to bet on, but we're starting with a full sheet of paper, not an empty sheet of paper, as we proceed down that road. What I want to invite you to do, if you don't think you've fully been heard today, let me put it that way, or if you have other ideas that these thoughts have sparked in you, you're going to get a survey emailed, a request to fill out a survey that's going to be emailed to you, and we really encourage you to fill that out. Not only will it give us feedback on the quality of what we did today, but there's two wonderful questions at the end that give you a chance to add anything else that you want to add to fill out our understanding of what the possibilities are. There's good, as I mentioned earlier, there will be a summary report of this meeting and of the whole collection of meetings available later this summer, and we want to make sure that you all get it. And finally, I want to end with a story. If you had a chance to look at my bio, you probably discovered one of my deep, dark secrets is that at one time in my life, I was a superintendent of schools, which frankly is the greatest hard job in America. And one of the advantages or disadvantages that I had is that my children were in the schools which I was superintending. So I was able to get a performance review every night. And I'd like to think my performance got better, but I'm not sure they would agree with that. And I learned so many things being a school superintendent. I lovingly say everything I know about leadership I learned in school, but it was in that job. And one day I wandered into a second grade classroom. One of the things I loved to do was to go see our kids in their classrooms and see what was happening. So I wandered into this second grade classroom and the teacher says, boys and girls, please, you know, stop what you're doing. We have a very important visitor. We have the superintendent of schools. Does anybody know what the superintendent does? Now this is second grade. Second grade is really important in the development of our children because by the time second grade is over, virtually all of our kids are able to read, they can do basic things, they've learned. They know they're smart. And the consequence of this is there's no question that they won't answer. So when the teacher said, does anybody know what the superintendent does? Every hand in the room went up. And I was thrilled, because I had no idea what the superintendent did. And here were, you know, 30 kids that knew the answer. And right down in front, there was this little guy, he had his hand up, just like the teacher had said, but his name was Michael, and Michael knew the answer to this question, and he just couldn't figure out why he should wait. So he jumps up and he says, I know the answer. And the teacher says, oh, okay, Michael, what's the answer? What does the superintendent do? Michael looks up and he says, oh, the superintendent, he's the guy in charge of Super Nintendo. And I gotta admit, it sounded like a better job. The teacher was brilliant, by the way, just a fabulous teacher. And she says to Michael, now Michael, that was a very creative interpretation of the language. But actually, the superintendent is the leader of our schools. Does anybody know what a leader is? Every hand in the room went up. And way in the back, I mean way in the back, was this little girl whose name was Andronetta. Andronetta had her arm raised so high that I was sure she was going to dislocate, you know, her shoulder. And thankfully, the teacher called on her. So Andronetta gets up, she gets all squared away, and the teacher says, okay, Andronetta, what does a leader do? Second grader, little black child in Central City, Minneapolis. Andronetta looks straight at me and she says, a leader is someone who goes out and changes things to make things better. Yeah, that was my reaction. I'd been to leadership school and failed a couple times. I read a whole bunch of leadership books. Here's Andronetta, second grader. This is the perfect definition of leadership, isn't it? A leader is someone who goes out and changes things to make things better. I didn't want to forget this, so I wrote it on my hand, And I go running out the front door of the building, and I race down to the central office for the school district because we had a meeting of all of our principals. So I rush in. We had 150 principals. I come rushing in, and I said, "Ladies and gentlemen, I got good news and I got bad news. What do you want to hear first?" "Oh, we want to hear the good news." "Here's the good news. I got our job description. A leader is someone who goes out and changes things to make things better." They thought it was fabulous. They said, "What's the bad news?" I said, "The bad news is that the second graders already know." Your communities already know. They know workforce is an important issue in South Dakota and certainly in Sioux Falls. They know that people like you are leaders in their community. And they're wondering, what is it you're going to change to make things better? They're waiting, they're expecting, they're looking to you. So my call to action to you is to live up to and embrace Andrenetta's job description. Go out, change things, make things better. You've already made an inventory of 30 or 40 good ideas. You don't have to pursue all of them. And the thing I learned, the most important lesson I learned from Andrenetta was that I didn't have to do it all tomorrow. I just needed to do one thing tomorrow. And one thing the day after that. And one thing the day after that. And a year later, 365 things would have been done. That's my invitation to you. Be the leaders your communities are counting on. And on this important issue, change things and make things better. Thank you very much.